Hey folks, welcome to our final lecture and discussion, which will not only prepare you for your last few chapter quizzes, but also prepare you for our final persuasive presentation. Let's dive right in. The first thing that we're going to discuss today is how to treat your audiences differently when you're giving a persuasive presentation as opposed to giving an informative or demonstrable presentation. We've already talked about some of these concepts before, such as expectation, knowledge, and attitude. Now we're going to discuss these principal factors in relationship to persuasive audiences. As you might expect, expectation is still of premium importance, including what your audience anticipates in regards to occasion, topic, and the mood of your speech. In other words, if they are attending a certain kind of formal occasion, they're not necessarily going to look for irreverence or even satire in the content of your speech. Knowledge is pertaining to the prior engagement and the sophistication of the information that your audience has about your topic, your argument, and your proposition. The higher your audience's knowledge, the more you're likely to trust their attitude, which includes their inclination, whether for or against your proposition, how strong those feelings are, otherwise known as potency, and the relevance that your proposition has to their everyday life. In other words, we might necessarily confuse knowledge and attitude in our everyday conversations, but these are two distinct things in regards to your audience. For example, your audience might have a very potent negative inclination to your argument, but that may just mean that they have a very low knowledge level. In other words, they don't know enough about your proposition in order to make an informed opinion. So knowing all three of those principal factors will help you to determine how to orient your approaches and how to make sure that those approaches work to maximum effect. Speaking of approaches, let's talk about those inclinations that we referred to in brief under principal factors. Generally, we would divide the approaches or inclinations of your audience into three distinct types: the opposed, the neutral, and the favorable. For opposed audiences, you want to take what are considered baby steps. You don't want to solicit any radical changes from them. Number one, because that's not likely to work. Most of people's inclinations towards your presentation, as well as their knowledge and their expectations, are often tied to their identities, who they think they are, their personalities. So if you foist upon them a radical change in their behavior, you're also threatening their identities, which is likely to be met with criticism or outright rebellion. So only consider moving them in a direction you would like, but don't expect them to make a complete change. Neutral audiences, of which your audiences are likely to become the most numerous, would be branched into three different categories: the uninformed, the impartial, and the apathetic. Uninformed audiences typically don't have the sophistication of information to become well-informed enough to make a decision either opposed or in favor of your proposition. So, in this instance, you're going to give them the basic or plenary arguments they need to become informed. Impartial audiences probably only know a surface amount of knowledge and might not necessarily have a potent feeling about the opposition or the favor to your proposition. So here you're going to provide more elaborate and secondary arguments that they might not have heard. Supply them with robust evidence that demonstrates why you carefully thought through both sides of the position and arrived at your own conclusions. And finally, apathetic arguments. These individuals typically have an attitude problem in regards to relevance. They simply don't see why this topic or proposition has anything to do with them, and so they don't have an either in favor or opposed opinion of it. So, usually it's best to use rational or logical arguments with audiences, but the exception is apathetic spectators. In this instance, you'll want to use pathos or rapport as much as possible. Develop empathic appeals to create a relationship with them so that they'll choose a side. Finally, favorable audiences, which we'll lump into the mildly and strongly in favor. Mildly in favor audiences are those at which you want to reinforce and strengthen the belief of. Give them ammunition so that when they become your avatars in their everyday lives, They'll know the kinds of arguments that are likely to win even complex debates. And then there's the strongly in favor, since these audiences are probably already aware of even very intricate arguments. These are the individuals that you want to build on the beliefs of and spur them to action upon it. In other words, you want to tell them what to do next. Vote for certain candidates, boycott certain products, visit certain charitable websites, etc., etc. Let's look at an instance of this. At the bottom, you see a demographic breakdown of an audience to an unspecified topic. There were 20 audience members, and if you'll notice, 75% or 15 of them are lumped into the opposed category, from highly to mildly opposed, with zero highly in favor. So as you might expect, you're probably only going to want to move this audience in the direction of your proposition. And the one thing you would definitely not want to do is spur them to action based on this breakdown. Understanding your audience's inclinations will help you make just as important decisions. Moving to the top of this slide, let's talk about the order and demography or organization and arrangement of persuasive presentations. It's a little bit different than the organization and structure of a traditional informative presentation, and I've broken down by percentage the amount of time you'll generally want to spend on each section of the speech. For example, both your attention getter and conclusion should only be about 10% of your speech. This solicits interest and at the end synthesizes your materials. Your proposition, which is your main argument, a dispassionate account of your facts and definitions of any important points, are usually about 20% of your overall speech. And then there's your affirmative argument. In other words, you want to tell in a compelling way why your audience should agree with you, what you stand for, and that should comprise no less than half of your overall argument. Then there's your negative rebuttal. This is where you preemptive strike whatever you think your opposition might say about your proposition. So, let's look at some examples of these by examining those parenthetical statements. Attention getter. Statistically, one out of every four women in today's audience have had an unsolicited, inappropriate advance in the past 12 months. Notice, they're using a startling statistic to get the attention of the audience. Airing their proposition, one of the sample statements is Black's Law Dictionary defines harassment as repeated, known, and inappropriate conduct. In this instance, we see that they are using a clinical, sterile, dictionary definition of the term they're going to be speaking about, instead of something more inflammatory. In their affirmative argument, they specifically state, "My 6-month implementation will make our campus safer for potential victims and accusers." In other words, they're going to lay out why the audience should agree with them. And then their negative rebuttal. Despite internal reports, the cost will be negligible. All right. So they've anticipated that a common negative criticism of their implementation is going to be its cost. So they've decided to go ahead and speak to that counter-argument ahead of time, so that their audience will be inoculated to it should they ever encounter it in the future. Now we're going to talk about the two dominant types of arguments that you're going to deploy within your speech. They are rational appeals, or sometimes called the Toulmin method, and emphatic appeals, or called the Rogerian method. You might have already encountered these types of arguments in a composition course in the past, but let's spend a little bit of time on them today. If we were to describe what a rational appeal is, they are arguments that are derived from credible evidence. In other words, they are arguments that your audience can objectively identify and vindicate for themselves. In other words, they don't have to adopt any of your premises, or, to use a term from our previous lecture and discussion, beg any questions in order to accept your proposition. This all begins with something called a claim. This is the assertion of your aim for the audience's acceptance. In other words, what you want your audience to do, or think, or even feel by the end of your speech. By next week, I want at least 5 people to investigate the harmful effects of social media addiction. So, this person has asserted their aim or goal, and also the stakes on which all of their arguments are going to be weighed or evaluated by the audience. There are different kinds of claims. For example, there's the speech effect. in which you try to assert empirically verifiable phenomena. You're trying to figure out whether something is or isn't true or correct. For example, you might argue whether or not global climate change is human or non-human made. So, as you can see, even in a speech of fact, there can often be very divisive issues surrounding various claims. Moving on from that is the speech of value, where you use facts in order to claim certain opinions, attitudes, and subjective evaluations as superior to others. So if you, for example, ever argued about one film's superiority to another film, you've been having a debate of value with your casual acquaintances or friends. Now, you can assert whatever kind of values you want, and the better your values, the more likely it is you'll get widespread acceptance. So, for example, asserting that a certain film is superior because it has more in-depth character development and a more cohesive narrative is probably going to appeal to most audience members more than "this movie had more exploding robots." A speech of policy is where you claim to advocate courses of action. So, you might say that you should vote for this candidate because they have always supported the American farmer, and then you'd use certain facts or implied values in order to solicit claims for that. Finally, classification. This is where you indicate what criteria are being used to define a term or category. That might seem boring on the surface, nothing more than a taxonomy, but think about, for example, the abortion debate. How we define or classify something like a fetus, something as having the sanctity of life or not having the sanctity of life, is a huge and divisive hot-button issue in our everyday lives. Grounds. This is the evidence that you deploy, which will include examples, statistics, reports, illustrations, observations, and reasoning. Going back to rational appeals, notice that all of these things are information that the audience can look up for themselves and verify. And finally, sources. These will be endorsements, experts, and authorities that will help you establish credibility with your audience. All of the Toulmin Method's rational appeals are fulcrumed on something called the warrant, a hinge that your audience will either agree or disagree with, which we'll define as an inferential leap between the grounds, which are your premises, and the claims, whether they be fact, classification, value, or policy. So let's look at this example. That dog is probably friendly. It is a golden retriever. The warrant, the fulcrum of that argument, is the premise that all golden retrievers are friendly. Premise, a message of persuasion that derives from the receiver's response. They have to make that inferential leap. So developing warrants is critical to devising a successful presentation. Here are some tips. Deploy greater evidence when your audience disregards your credibility. In other words, the less people trust you, the more that they'll have to trust your rational appeals. And use evidence that's been proven more persuasive when it's stated in specific terms. Notice the parenthetical. In every case, the trial group stated they were afraid of losing their jobs if they spoke out. So here are those fears expressed in their own words. Notice that this person is being as sterile and as clinical as possible. They're even quoting the word afraid from a previous study or report. They're not using their own words, they're using the words of others. Use grounds that are novel or immediate to the audience. In other words, what do the experts or authorities of this particular group of audience members say about the issue, and how can you pivot that to your advantage? And finally, provide illustrations for linking both your grounds and your claim. In other words, your warrant might seem self-evident to you, but to your audience, not all golden retrievers might be friendly, so demonstrating that as clearly and succinctly as possible is likely to contribute to your overall success. Here's an example. Sarah came to the conclusion that large companies had less oversight in assessing manager training. She made the decision to independently approach human resources. So, the implied warrant or inference there is the fact that because Sarah works at a small company, her manager might not know to refer her to human resources. That's the argument that's implied within this claim or statement. But notice that this person created an illustration to help their audience leap from that inference to that claim. Let's look at just a few minutes of a presentation from G.T. Bynum. You might not know this, but G.T. Bynum currently serves as the mayor of Tulsa, and in order to win, he had to beat out a two-term incumbent by choosing data over rhetoric, and this speech is one in which he shares how politicians of both parties are beginning to join his movement. As you carefully watch, I'd like to identify several of the speech's most persuasive claims, and maybe even record them down.
So last year I ran for mayor of my hometown, Tulsa, Oklahoma. And I was the underdog, running against a two-term incumbent, and my opponent ran the classic partisan playbook. He publicized his endorsement of Donald Trump. He publicized a letter that he sent to President Obama protesting Syrian refugees, even though none of them were coming to Tulsa. He ran ads on TV that my kids thought made me look like Voldemort, and sent out little gems in the mail like this. Never mind that America's most liberal labor union, as defined by this ad, was actually the Tulsa Firefighters Union, hardly a famed bastion of liberalism. Never mind that while she was running for president and he was serving in his final year in that office, Hillary, Brock, and I could just never find the time to get together and yuck it up about the Tulsa mayor's race. Never mind that I, like my opponent, am a Republican. When something like this hits you in a campaign, you have to decide how you're going to respond. And we had a novel idea. What if, instead of responding with partisanship, we responded with a focus on results? What if we ran a campaign that was not about running against someone, but was about bringing people together behind a common vision? And so we decided to respond not with a negative ad, but with something people find even sexier, data points. And so we emphasize things like increasing per capita income in our city, increasing our city's population. And we stuck to those relentlessly throughout the campaign, always bringing it back to those things by which our voters could measure in a very transparent way how we were doing and hold me accountable if I got elected. And a funny thing happened when we did that. Tulsa's home to one of the most vibrant young professional populations in the country, and they took notice of this approach. We have in our culture, in our city, an ethos where our business leaders don't just run companies, they run philanthropic institutions and nonprofits. And those folks took notice. We have parents who are willing to sacrifice today so that their kids can have a better future, and those people took notice too. And so on election day, I, G.T. Bynum, a guy whose name reminds people of a circus promoter, a guy with the raw animal magnetism of a young Orville Redenbacher, I won the election by 17 points. And we did it with the support of Republicans and Democrats. Now, why is that story and that approach so novel? Why do we always allow ourselves to fall back on philosophical disagreements that ultimately lead to division? I believe it is because politicians find it easier to throw the red meat out to the base than to innovate. The conventional wisdom is that to win an election, you have to dumb it down and play to your constituency's basest divisive instincts. And when somebody wins an election like that, they win. That's true. But the rest of us lose. And so what we need to do is think about how can we change that dynamic? How can we move to in a direction where partisanship is replaced with policy? And fortunately, there
Notice how explicitly Bynum, in this particular presentation, mentions the importance of warrants, claims, and grounds. That whenever he was attacked, he just reinforced within his campaign the relationships and links between his aims or goals, and all of the evidence that he could use to supplant his own arguments, his own proposition, and his own plan for governance. And it ended up working. Because whenever you use rational appeals, you are essentially treating your audience as an agent. They can make a choice, instead of playing upon their emotions, which doesn't allow them to make a choice and perhaps even threatens their identity. So that's an example of the Toulmin method. Now let's look at something called the Rogerian method of persuasion, or sometimes called the congruence method as opposed to the rational appeals method. So we often think of persuasion purely as an us versus them paradigm. But, as Carl Rogers, the creator of the Rogerian method, states, in my early professional years, and it's important to note that Rogers worked as a psychotherapist, I was asking the question, how can I treat or cure or change this person? Now I would phrase the question, how can I provide a relationship which this person may use for their own personal growth? So if we were to define the congruence method, it would be persuading audiences via shared values and interests. In other words, instead of trying to slowly move them in the direction of your proposition, you show them how your proposition helps them become more of themselves, reinforces their identity more than their current behavior. So this has a very specific process. Number one, you identify principal areas of agreement between yourself and your opposition, which usually isn't too hard. After all, most of us have very similar goals, regardless of how we are opposed to one another in other respects. And then you create a composition, a speech, a debate, or even a piece of writing that clearly outlines or identifies the ways in which your proposition upholds those shared values and interests. And then supply arguments that deploy evasive grounds. In other words, you accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative. You provide neutral terms that everyone can agree on, and you supply evidence that allows a person to understand that your ground, your claims, your argument, your proposition will help them become more of themselves. So how does that happen? Well, there are a couple of things that you can do within the congruence method. For example, appreciating that audiences are often motivated by loss more than gain. So, for example, look at this particular claim from another speech. Evangelical claiming the need for missionary projects when needs must agree that an influx of immigrants is a wonderful opportunity for conversions. In other words, what this person is saying is that evangelical Christians self-identify as individuals that want to convert as many people as possible. So that means a reduction in the amount of new potential conversions would make them less evangelical. Casting the issue in listeners' terms, good stewards of God's creation see the need for the EPA's conservation efforts in the Pacific Northwest. Notice that they've essentially switched the term environmentalists with good stewards of God's creation, because they're using a dog whistle, something only an evangelical Christian might hear, appreciate, and understand, in order to get them to accede to the same behavior as any like-minded environmentalist. Also incite audiences to dissonance, in other words, create a identity crisis. In other words, if they are for a set of values, but the behavior that they're currently adopting goes against those values, they'll often agree with you to retain their identity. Love, charity, peace, none of these virtues seem synonymous with the candidate in question's rhetoric. So if they continue to support whoever that candidate is, then they might have to abandon the concept that they completely uphold love, charity, and peace. Finally, deliver your weakest evidence in the middle of the presentation, because typically, audiences are more likely to remember the first and last thing that you say. So if they're going to be less likely to remember what's in the middle of your presentation, it might as well be the weakest arguments. Let's look at an instance of the Rogerian method, not by Carl Rogers, but by Fred Rogers, as he testifies in 1969 before the Senate Subcommittee on Communications and Commerce. Here, Fred Rogers, or Mr. Rogers, as you probably know him as, is literally fighting for the sanctity of public broadcasting's children's programming. And you'll notice at the beginning that the person that he is exchanging or conveying information with, Senator Pastore from Wisconsin, is reticent, if not openly hostile, to his position. So I'd like you to identify one or several ways the Rogerian methods that Fred Rogers uses helps him accede to his goals.
Now, Mr. Rogers is certainly one of the best things that's ever happened to public television, and his Peabody Award is testament to that fact. We in public television are proud of Fred Rogers, and I'm proud to present Mr. Rogers to you now.
Fred. All right, Rogers, you got the floor.
Senator Pastore, this is a philosophical statement and would take about 10 minutes to read, so I'll not do that. One of the first things that a child learns in a healthy family is trust, and I trust what you have said that you will read this. It's very important to me. I care deeply about children. My first children.
Will it make you happy if you read it?
I'd just like to talk about it, if it's
all right.
My first children's program was on WQED 15 years ago, and its budget was $30. Now, with the help of the Sears Roebuck Foundation and National Educational Television, as well as all of the affiliated stations, each station pays to show our program. It's a unique kind of funding in educational television. With this help, now our program has a budget of $6,000. It may sound like quite a difference, but $6,000 pays for less than 2 minutes of cartoons, 2 minutes of animated, what I sometimes say, bombardment. I'm very much concerned, as I know you are, about what's being delivered to our children in this country. And I've worked in the field of child development for 6 years now, trying to understand the inner needs of children. We deal with such things as the inner drama of childhood. We don't have to bop somebody over the head to make him to make drama on the screen. We deal with such things as getting a haircut or the feelings about brothers and sisters and the kind of anger that arises in simple family situations. And we speak to it constructively.
How long a program is it?
It's a half hour every day. Most channels schedule it in the noontime as well as in the evening. WETA here has scheduled it in the late afternoon.
Could we get a copy of this so that we can see it? Maybe not today, but I'd like to see the program.
I'd like very much for you
to see it. I'd like to see the program itself, or any one of them, you see.
We made 100 programs for EEN, the Eastern Educational Network, and then when the money ran out, people in Boston and Pittsburgh and Chicago all came to the fore and said, we've got to have more of this neighborhood expression of care. And this is what I give. I give an expression of care every day to each child to help him realize that he is unique. I end the program by saying, you've made this day a special day by just your being you. There's no person in the whole world like you. And I like you just the way you are. And I feel that if we in public television can only make it clear that feelings are mentionable and manageable, we will have done a great service for mental health. I think that it's much more dramatic that two men could be working out their feelings of anger. Much more dramatic than showing something of gunfire. I'm constantly concerned about what our children are seeing. And for 15 years, I have tried in this country and Canada to present what I feel is a meaningful expression of care.
Do you narrate it?
I'm the host, yes. And I do all the puppets, and I write all the music, and I write all the scripts.
Well, I'm supposed to be a pretty tough guy, and this is the first time I've had goosebumps for the last 2 days.
Well, I'm grateful, not only for your goosebumps, but for your interest in our kind of communication. Could I tell you the words of one of the songs which I feel is very important?
Yes.
This has to do with that good feeling of control, which I feel that the children need to know is there. And it starts out, what do you do with the mad that you feel? And that first line came straight from a child. I work with children, doing puppets in very personal communication with small groups. What do you do with the mad that you feel when you feel so mad you could bite? When the whole wide world seems oh so wrong, and nothing you do seems very right. What do you do? Do you punch a bag? Do you pound some clay or some dough? Do you round up friends for a game of tag or see how fast you go? It's great to be able to stop when you've planned a thing that's wrong and be able to do something else instead and think this song. I can stop when I want to, can stop when I wish, can stop, stop, stop any time. And what a good feeling to feel like this, and know that the feeling is really mine. Know that there's something deep inside that helps us become what we can. For a girl can be someday a lady, and a boy can be someday a man.
I think it's wonderful. I think it's wonderful. Looks like you just earned the $20 million.
So what we see in this particular instance is Rogers aligning or making congruent his values with the values of Pastore. Did you notice that he even used Pastore's own term, goosebumps? And that he created loss aversion in Pastore. I know that you uphold these certain values and beliefs, so do we. So if you abandoned funding for this particular program, you'll essentially be losing some of the sanctity or integrity of your own identity. Because of this, Rogers secured $10 million more than public broadcasting was asking for in children's programming, which means public broadcasting was able to invest more revenue into developing other children's programming, including works like Sesame Street. And it was all down to the careful use of the Rogerian method in this testimony. All right, folks, that's all we've got for today's lecture and discussion. Remember, next Monday is our final presentation, Presentation 5. If you have any questions about it between then and now, feel free to reach out to me via email. I'll also be sending you information in the next several days about your final exam and any end of semester ideas as well. Take care in the meantime.